All right, it's movie night announcement time again. Hit it, Marshall.
Winds in the east. Mist coming in. Like something is brewing. About to begin.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are beginning our descent into Los Angeles.
Welcome, Mrs. P.L. Travers, to the City of Angels.
It smells like...
jasmine.
Chlorine. And sweat.
Introducing the creator of our beloved Mary.
Poppins. Never, ever just Mary.
Now, where is Mr. Disney?
She's here.
Well, Pamela Travers. You can't imagine how excited I am to finally meet you.
Would you mind? My name is Mrs. Travers, Mr. Disney.
Oh, Walt, now you gotta call me Walt. 20 years ago, I made a promise to my daughters that I would make your Mary Poppins fly off the pages of your books. I promised them, Pam.
I know what he's going to do to her. She'll be cavorting and twinkling.
He can't make the film unless you grant the rights.
Damn.
Ideas.
What kind of ideas?
Constables responsible. Now, how does that sound?
No. Responsible is not a word.
We made it up.
Well, unmake it up.
She won't approve Dick Van Dyke.
No.
The Lantis house doesn't look like that. No,
it's all wrong.
It's all wrong?
Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
Stop! Mary Poppins is not for sale. I won't have her turned into one of your silly cartoons.
Says the woman who sent a flying nanny with a talking umbrella to save the children.
You think Mary Poppins has come to save the children? Oh, dear.
Mr. Travers, what am I missing here? I'm wondering what I have to do to make you happy. You know, you've never been to Disneyland, and that's the happiest place on Earth.
No, please.
Well, when does anybody get to go to Disneyland with Walt Disney himself?
There he is.
Where did she come from?
Mary Poppins and the Bankses. They're family to me.
Mary Poppins was a real person? So it's not the children she comes to save. It's their father. It's your father.
You don't know what she means to me.
I won't disappoint you. I swear every time a person walks into a movie house, they will rejoice. Don't you want to finish the story? The boys have come up with an idea. I think it's going to make you happy.
You didn't bring me all the way here to tell me that.
Oh, no. I had a wager. I couldn't get you on a ride. I just won $20.
Yeah!
And that is our April 13th, our April version of our congregational movie night, our focus for 2024 being on real people, real events that we admire. So we hope to see as many of you there as possible. They are a good time. I ask you if you anything you want to bring as a potluck-style snack to share, we will be providing the basics. And I hope to see as many of you there. We will try and get underway right around 7 as well. So please be prompt, but please be welcome. Thank you.
Dear pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength and shield. To you alone may my spirit. water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength and shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Good morning. Welcome. He is risen. This is good news proclamation as we continue the Easter season of the Christian liturgical calendar. Easter includes the 50 days that began last Sunday and continues until we celebrate the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost. Today our focus is on how we as Easter people witness to our world. And, oh, good timing. Great to see all your faces. It's wonderful. I am so thankful for those who are participating here today. A lot of goes into the work in the behind the scenes of preparing emblems, of the audiovisual, of saying prayer for peace. And, of course, thank you for Tara for helping assist this morning, and of course Cathy, who I will introduce just before she gives her testimony. So now let us continue with the call to worship, and I greet those who will be watching online. I greet you in the name of Christ. On the very first day of Easter, the disciples were mourning and confused. The teacher they had followed had been crucified. They lost not only their leader and teacher, but their friend. Jesus taught love and acceptance. His nonviolent response to authorities was confusing and unexpected. Jesus did not lead and die in a battle to overturn the powers and principalities, ushering in a new way of life. It looked like Jesus had lost. Further, the hope of the Lord's Prayer to create God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven had seemingly died on the cross with him. The disciples' experience of the resurrection was not at all like our Easter celebrations. The disciples had more questions than answers. The announcement of the empty tomb was shocking. Although Jesus had foreshadowed the events, the news that he had risen was surprising. I would love to know what the disciples were thinking and doing during this time, but the New Testament not only gives us a few glimpses of what happened between day 1 and day 50 of the first Easter season. What will we think and do as we once again hear the good news proclaimed, he is risen? For us, the importance of the resurrection might get lost because it is not a surprise that forces us to seek meaning. He is risen is not just a proclamation of a singular event. This good news invites and sends us. God invites us to shape our lives anew as Easter people. God sends us the blessing of the Holy Spirit to embody and share the message and ministry of the living Christ. He is risen when we live Christ's mission.
For such a time, for such a day as this have we been called to know our name, beloved of God, and bear it to the world, and bear it to the world. In such a world, Lord, we are home, say, by your grace to loved of God, be he loved and blessed, whatever strength we own. He belongs not to our might or power, but comes from God alone, but comes from God alone. For such a time, and for such a day,
gracious and loving God, we give thanks for the opportunity that we have to come together today to worship and praise in your presence. We ask you to be with each of us throughout this service and to especially be with our sister Cathy as she gives her testimony this morning. We ask you to bless us to your use and to your service, and this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Will you bow with me for the prayer for peace? We thank you for your mission of peace in our lives. We know your message is for all people, for all times, and for all places. As you move among us this day, help us replicate your steps to share your peace with others. Help us carry your message of shalom to those who suffer, those who are lost, those who have no voice in this world. Help us share your gospel of worth of all people to those throughout our communities, countries, and even your world. Guide us, Holy Spirit, as people of peace. Amen.
I'm not going to talk long because I'm looking forward to hearing our next speaker. Cathy is a dear family member of this congregation, I'll say. Her and Tom are wonderful. Now, we who know Cathy, it's sometimes, I will say, sometimes with a personality such as her, we'll say, oh, chatty Cathy, there she goes, this and that. But we know how special she is to us and how important. And we thankfully, there is quite the support here today among family and friends. And so I uplift Cathy as she gives her testimony and what God has done in her life. And so, without any further ado, let's welcome and listen and take in her story, Cathy Wright.
Thank you, Dariq. Thank you, Dariq. Can I just have... Okay, can everyone hear me? Okay. Good morning, everyone. This is my story. It's about friendship and self-acceptance. A little background. My father was a sheet metal worker and house builder. My mom was a secretary and a very good seamstress. I am from Paris, Ontario. As a young girl, I saw myself having a husband, two kids, and a home, and a career in the helping field. I went to Fanshawe College for 3 years and studied to become a developmental service worker. After graduation, I was employed by Community Living London right away. After 14 years, I struggled with being a manager, so I took a buyout. When my marriage broke down, I was devastated. I saw my family doctor, and he recommended an antidepressant. And I saw a psychiatrist at the LPH hospital. I mentioned that after being depressed, I would feel euphoric. She mentioned that I might be bipolar. I was sent for another referral, and my meds were changed. The definition of bipolar disorder is a mood disorder formerly known as manic depressive, characterized by alternating periods of mania and major depression. Typically, the moods of a person with bipolar disorder will swing from high and irritable to sad and hopeless, and back again with periods of normal moods in between. The meds calmed my mind down. I went back to school to become a personal support worker, working with seniors, which I loved, in their own homes. I also worked on weekends at an agency called Cheshire, where I helped people with physical disabilities. Besides that, I was a mother. Brianna was a happy baby and child. We spent endless hours together, including my trips to Brantford to visit my mom and stepfather. All through school, Brianna was an excellent student. Outside school, she was involved in brownies, a sign language course, a kid's cooking class, among other things. She began working at 16 at Food Basics and later worked at Shaw's Ice Cream in White Oaks Mall. She always had a good work ethic. She was extremely social then and still is, even though she has two children. Anyway, after graduating from the hospitality program at Fanshawe College, her first career job was at Guest House on the Mount, where she went from half-time to full-time to manager in just a few years. Then London Life, and later Canadian Mental Health Association, CMHA. She and Rory were married last summer, and they have two children, Connor 5 and Marlo 16 months. Over the years, her father and I alternated weekends looking after Brianna. I owned a house at the time, but even with two jobs, I couldn't make ends meet. I sold the house, and Bri and I moved into a two-bedroom apartment. A friend of mine suggested applying for an educational assistant job. I was hired right away on a casual basis, then became permanent. My mood seemed stable. I had high energy and spoke very fast. Stress affects us all. A reduction in the number of educational assistants at my school made it necessary to apply for another job at another school within the school board. At my new school, the children were way more challenging, and I started to suffer from stress and anxiety. My stepfather passed away in June of 2008. It didn't occur to me. My mood was very low that summer. When I returned to work, because we had summers off, because I was an EA, I went through periods of 2 days working and 2 days off. This was a trend. Another week it would repeat itself. A couple of days I couldn't get out of bed. My vice principal suggested I go to my psychiatrist. He said I was in a mixed state, which defined as the simultaneous symptoms of mania and depression occurring at the same time, and took me off work for 6 weeks. It was considered short-term disability, but it lasted a lot longer. The sadness continued through Christmas and into the next year, 2009. Something triggered me in February, and on an impulse, I wrote a note to Brianna that I was leaving town, which upset Brianna terribly. I drove to Goderich and got a hotel room with the intention of harming myself. Luckily, I didn't. My mom and sister tried to call me, but I was a mess emotionally. I didn't sleep, and I drove home at 6 the next morning. Someone was looking over me because it was pouring rain and there were transport trucks on the road. My daughter Brianna had already called my doctor, and I saw him 2 days later. He wrote a letter to the emergency psych department at Vic. I was transported late at night from the back of Vic Hospital by cab, due to the lack of ambulances, to the South Street campus, where there were more psych beds. I remember looking out the window of the cab at Gwen and Anne, my girlfriend Gwen is here, and they were in the parking lot waving at me. I was sedated, and when they checked me in, all I remember was they handed me a toothbrush and showed me a bed. In the morning, the drapes around my bed were pulled open, and I remember a handsome male nurse staring at me. Where am I? Who are you? I said. I was shown around. It was like something out of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. The doors were locked everywhere, and you could only go outside if you signed out or were surprised by friends and relatives. In the evenings, patients lined up to get their meds in little cups. One of my greatest enjoyments was to get up early, shower, and race to the one TV in the leisure room to watch Ellen DeGeneres because she made me laugh. Notice some laughter. Brianna, my mom, and all my friends visited me. After 6 weeks, I was encouraged to switch to a day program where they worked on meditation, goal setting, diet, art therapy, everything they could think of. The first couple years after my 2009 hospitalization, I was very depressed. I felt I had no purpose. I felt like a failure. Who was I? What was I going to do? I had been this high-functioning woman. I couldn't even work under the insurance rules. But I eventually learned it's not what I don't have, but being grateful for what I do have. My daughter, my wonderful girlfriends, an excellent doctor, my mom at the time, my mom, and even my handsome, intelligent boyfriend, who introduced me to this church and eventually our grandchildren. To end, I would like to read a quote that I came across in Victoria Hospital's Track to Wellness program. Okay, so you may think that you are completely insignificant in this world, but someone drinks coffee from the favorite cup that you gave them. Someone heard a song on the radio that reminded them of you. Someone read a book that you recommended and plunged headfirst into it. Someone smiled after a hard day's work because they remembered the joke you told them today. Someone loves themselves a little bit more because you gave them a compliment. Never think that you have no influence whatsoever. Your trace, which you leave behind with every good deed, cannot be erased. Thank you for listening to me.
When we are
Just before I read the scripture reading, it is good to take a moment to reflect on the testimony we heard. You know, we think we know who people are, especially family or friends, members, and yet it is good to hear some other details in people's lives and how life intertwines to do things. To have them here and to be able to give their story. So let's reflect on Kathy's testimony and our own lives and our testimonies. Scripture reading is taken from 1 John 1:1. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard and what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testify to it and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. What we have seen and heard, we also declare to you, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. The gospel writer of John shares, joy of life as disciples is most fully realized in a loving and inclusive community living the ethics of Christ's peace. That joy is the outcome of the life of faithful discipleship, and that we should take joy too. That when we fail and fall short of the mark, Christ is there to advocate for us in koinonia. One in community.
As children of
For I received from the Lord that what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Welcome at Christ's table. The Lord's Supper or Communion is a sacrament in which we remember the life, death, resurrection, and continuing presence of Jesus Christ. In community of Christ, we also experience communion as an opportunity to renew our baptismal covenant and to be formed as disciples who live Christ's mission. Others might have different or added understandings within their faith traditions. We invite all who participate in the Lord's Supper to do so in the love and peace of Jesus Christ.
I invite you to kneel as far as you're able facing the emblems as I read the combined prayer. Eternal God, we ask you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, to bless and sanctify this bread and wine to the souls of all those who receive them, that they may eat and drink in remembrance of the body and blood of your Son, and witness to you, O God, that they are willing to take upon them the name of your Son and always remember him and keep the commandments which he has given them, that they may always have his Spirit to be with them. Amen.
Oblation, the first Sunday of the month, focuses disciples' generous response on one of our mission's initiatives, abolish poverty and end suffering, which includes oblation ministry. During the disciples' generous response, we focus on aligning our heart with God's heart. Mission, through our offerings, we are able to join in making God's work visible in the world. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what they sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. Our theme today is Easter People Witness. How do we as Easter people show through giving that Jesus lives in us?
Sending forth today is from Doctrine and Covenants 162, 3a to b. Do not be discouraged. You have not been promised an easy path, but you have been assured that the Spirit that calls you will also accompany you. That Spirit is even now touching alive the souls of those who feel the passion of discipleship burning deeply within. Many others will respond if you are persistent in your witness and diligent in your mission of the world.